Just came in a moment ago. We do have a sign-up sheet out front, outside the meeting room as you get off the elevator. For those interested in signing up to speak, if you'd please do so now. Once we begin the hearing, we'll begin taking comments from people as they've signed up to speak. Thank you.
Can we add names to the list, Scott, after we get going? Can you see them?
Can I tell your name?
No, you can't. Okay. I'll shake your hand though.
Okay.
Good to see you.
Well, that's okay.
Thank you.
Glad to have you back in the saddle.
Thank you. Thank you for your post.
That was a weird gene altering.
That was funny.
City of Cumming. To my immediate right is Danny Bennett,
one of the engineers, co-authors of the remediation plan with contracting engineers. And to his right is Dr. Brian Wellington, Newfields Company, one of the other co-authors of the remediation plan. A few things I do want to mention before we get started. I would like to ask you to please silence all of your devices so there's no interruption during the time that people are speaking. When you do come up, your name is called, come up to the podium, if you please would give us your name and your complete address. As you're probably all aware, you have 10 minutes in which time to make your comments on the plan. That would include any comments which require responses from one of our plan authors here. So we'd ask that you keep your comments direct. We ask that, if possible, if they're not repetitive comments by multiple speakers, if someone else has made a comment or something that you want to make, of course, more than welcome to, but we ask in the interest of time that we not have repetitive comments. As you know, again, this is part of a process that we're going through right now, the City of Cumming and the Mashburn Trust, in addressing a dam breach that occurred last year. And we have submitted our remediation plan to the appropriate agencies, to the Georgia Environmental Protection Division and to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. We're in the process right now of going through revision of those plans, which includes public comments from this public hearing. So without any further delay, we have as our first listed speaker, Mr. Brent Meadows.
My name is Brent Meadows. I own the property at 795 Timberlake Trail. I wanted to thank the Mashburns for arranging for us to have this opportunity to see this evening. And as I understand it, that was the idea of the Mashburns and not the City of Cumming. So I'm thankful for the opportunity to be able to come speak this evening. In the public notice, there was identification that you're going to address the concerns. Are you intending to address the concerns here tonight? And if they're not addressed this evening, when will they be addressed and how will they be addressed?
I imagine they will be addressed through the further revisions and through the detailed engineering that will be supplied to the remediation plan by Mr. Bennett and Dr. Wellington.
So if the question is the answer, this evening, when will it be answered?
Difficult to say because it will require, as you said, further work on the remediation plan, and we don't exactly know. I could perhaps refer to one of the gentlemen here if they want to answer that as to how long it might take to develop the details of the plan.
Might I suggest that you consider having a second additional public hearing in order to give answers adequately to the public? Instead of just leaving it, well, we may or may not see an answer because I anticipate that there will be questions that you don't have answers for this evening. So I think that would be my first concern to ask that be addressed, that there be a second public hearing. Also, I'm aware that it's alleged that the public notice for this meeting, while it did show up in Forsyth County News section, I believe, A, page 2, it did not show up in the legal notice section of the Forsyth County News, and I have concerns because then it does not pick up by the Georgia Association of Public Notifications, and anybody who wished to be here wouldn't be allowed to speak. Also, can we confirm that the audio and the stenographer or the court reporter, that it's all operational? The City of Cumming has a mysterious pattern and habitual for losing, quite honestly, recorded tapes and that thing. Are we working out there? It's working? Your celebration with it?
Great.
Wonderful. I have concerns about the plan that was submitted. The plan is dated in August of this past year. The plan is not reflective of what currently exists. I would ask that the plan be revised. I have concerns with the plan. I would ask, is the plan and has it been confirmed that it was completed by a certified engineer who is registered with the appropriate authorities, any appropriate authority that might be applicable in the state of Georgia? Is the engineer who did the work or the company who did the work at the time of August, were they licensed to do business in the state of Georgia? Would be my question. And if that is the case, I would request that all those credentials be supplied as a response to this concern that I want you to address.
Yes, my name is Brian Wellington. I work for Newfields. Newfields is licensed and registered to work in Georgia, and I'm also a licensed engineer in Georgia.
And you prepared the plan?
I prepared part of the plan, yes.
Oh, who else prepared the plan?
Mr. Bennett.
Yes, I'm licensed in the state of Georgia since the early 90s. And I'm working under the Georgia laws as far as engineering.
Is it a problem for either of you to submit your credentials so that we can verify that at the time the plan was created that everybody was in compliance with the state of Georgia, please?
I think that would be a record on the Secretary of State's website.
I'm not asking for the Secretary of what website. I'm asking you, sir, and you, sir, to supply your credentials.
Submit credentials to whom, Mr. Bass?
To this body, to this group. As addressing the concerns that this plan here, and I'm sorry, but the plan has some serious failures and flaws. Quite honestly, I think there needs to be some, in the infamous words, I think there needs to be some house cleaning. Is Chief Tatum around? Maybe he can remove this plan. I don't see Chief Tatum, but that was another day. On the plan, there is a notation that indicates on the northwest side of Sanders Road that there is a major silt deposit. There's not a major silt deposit there. You can see all of the twigs and the trees and the plants that were growing there before. Now on the south side of Sanders Road, oh, there's a good 8, 9, 10 feet of silt that goes out about 250 feet into Lake Lanier. But the plan is flawed and it shows that it has silt and what is identified as a major silt deposit immediately adjacent to Sanders Road on the northwest side. That is false, and that is not reflective of what is actually taking place. Also, I have a concern that the plans note that all dredgings will be placed behind the rock dam number one that is shown on the same map in the same plan, and that dredgings, all dredgings, are going to be located in this area. Now, for me, I have a concern that you're taking out Lake Lanier and putting it back where it just came from. I'd like to see that dirt, that silt, go somewhere else so that it never has a chance to show back up in case rock dam number one fails. Well, we're just back to step number one, and I consider that to be illogical and not appropriate. Also, I've heard that there may be another location for dredging that's somewhere adjacent or at Lake Alice. Can anybody address where those dredgings are going to go? And while you're addressing that, if we can just hold my time, go ahead.
Basically, the settling basin would be an intermediate basin to allow some settling prior to removing the silt from the site. All the dredging would be placed there at one time. So a drying agent would be applied to silt, and then it would be removed from the site. If there's a, if there's a site that it seems to be fit to accommodate the dried out dredgings. There's been mention of, I think there's a power line easement. There's a couple of places out there that's been discussed for placement of dredgings, but there's no firm placement area within the Lake Alice vicinity. As of now, all our discussions has been to dewater the dredgings and haul and remove them from the site, which is what we intend on doing, unless we find a place suitable for the dredgings that where they would not come go back in the lake.
I would ask for a prohibition of any of the dredgings from other than temporarily being placed, that any permanent placement of any dredgings would not be allowed anywhere within 1 mile of this location. The idea behind that is I don't want any of these dredgings to go back into Lake Alice. It's been alleged that there's going to be an attempt to reclaim the former lake bottom of Lake Allison to develop that property. I would also ask that, that area that was formerly the 12 acres approximately, that it be permanently prohibited and deed restricted from any development ever. Also prohibiting that same property from ever seeking a Section 404 permit. A Section 404 permit is paving and piping over streams. Who will be overseeing the work that will be done? Is that the city of Cumming? Or their assignees, I suppose?
Yes.
I have concerns about that because the city of Cumming is conflicted and contaminated. They're the ones who caused this problem, and now they're going to be the ones who are overseeing it. That, to me, is like a fox watching the hen house and the fox building the hen house also. And I would ask that there be an independent third party that is selected to oversee this, that's paid for by the city of Cumming, that oversees it. The city of Cumming has been a habitual offender of pollution and assaults on Atlanta's drinking water and also Lake Lanier. Previously, there have been sewer spills that have taken place that went unchecked, no notice given to the neighbors. This event that took place here, there were no notice given to the neighbors not to swim there. When the development of Marketplace and the Best Buy and Dick's, there was no temporary sediment pond, which resulted in one of the largest EPD fines. I could go on and on about the failures of the city of Cumming, but quite honestly, in my opinion, they cannot be trusted and should not be allowed to oversee this project. Also, I would ask that you review all the photos that and all the comments that are posted on Focus On For Site related to this matter going back to that time. Also, I would ask you to go to aboutforsite.com and also to gather that information as well to make that a part of the record. There are a number of comments that have been made there. I would ask, why not a dam? And why not a dam early on? When this first took place, the city of Cumming, as the local issuing authority, assuredly had the authority to take emergency action to secure this, but yet they denied ownership.
Excuse me, you have one more.
Did that account for the response times that you got sent?
No, sir.
Okay. And so the city of Cumming failed to take action immediately. They denied ownership. And so my concern is that the city of Cumming, being a habitual offender, how are we assured that they're going to clean out behind the weir in the future? I would request that there be a $5 million bond placed so that if any problems arise, that would be available for a remedy in case the sovereign city of the city of Cumming goes out of business. Is this the best for the community? I've read in the paper that you guys have said this is the best. So I would challenge you, and I call your bluff. What is less than what you've proposed that would be acceptable to the EPD? Because I suggest to you that you're doing the absolute bare minimum possible, and that you're not doing anything more than you have to do. So I challenge you, tell me what you can do less that would be acceptable to the EPD. And if that's the case, I would ask you to do more than what you're doing.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Next speaker is Mr. Ron Williams.
I'm Ron Williams, and I live at 1280 Buford Dam Way. And that's been for the last 26 years, and 12 years prior to that at Ball Ridge Marina in a houseboat. So I enjoy it here, that's why I'm here, and I'm speaking really for a lot of people around our area that just absolutely thirst for one thing, and that's information. I've got the reclamation plan. We're not engineers. I have got all, everything. We're not lawyers. We're not engineers. And we're not politicians. But everybody that I've talked to, there's one thing that we have in common, and that is I don't know. I do not know. And so we just want to know if Lake Lanier from Sanders Road, let's say the Habersham Marina, will be brought back to previous levels. We live here because we love the lake, we love the community, and we love the access to it with our boats and with our docks. And for years and years, and for 26 years here, for 26 years, we've been paying, or I've been paying taxes commensurate with an acre and a quarter on the lake, which I love very much. And I don't think you've ever had a word from me damning anything I did there. So I've been a good taxpayer, as have my lake friends. We just want to know when dredging starts, when and where, what parts of the lake that affect us are in the dredging plan. I'm on one side, I've got neighbors on the other side, what about the middle, et cetera. You know, we just don't know where and how far down, et cetera. The engineering aspects, which I've got the printout here of the program, which I went to William & Mary, which is a liberal arts college, and I couldn't read that thing on a bed. So I'm taking for granted that there are people that are smart enough to know that as taxpayers, all we want is to have what we had 2 years ago, 3 years ago. And the thing that kind of is ironic is that we've seen years of drought which rendered our docks inoperable. And now we're seeing some of my neighbors with their docks are inoperable because of rain. So it's both ways. Mother Nature is a curious animal. We got an opportunity for the taxpayers and for the city, for the county, to come together on something that we have invested a lot of money in, and we're here because of the value of waterfront property. And we want that to remain. And I'm 72 years old, has an estate value for my grandson and my daughter, et cetera. So all we want to know is what we're doing to go back at least to the previous level. I'm not hurting as badly as some of my other neighbors that can't get a boat in their dock now because it is completely silted up. Those are the people I would like to get some answers to. So thank you very much for the opportunity to vent in front of you or just to exchange some information. I love being here and I love it working well. Thank you.
There's a flood easement that the lake has that's upstream of Sanders Road. we have to maintain that flooding volume in regards to the core's flooding. And the core has been very specific in saying that whatever silt is in the cove that was caused by the dam breach will be removed. So there's been no ifs, ands, and buts about that during the course of discussions over the last 3 or 4 months. The sediment that was in the cove due to the dam breach will be removed. And that would be a part of the permit that we would be procuring from the Corps of Engineers.
Does that include the silt after the dam breach from the bottom of Lake House? I said, does the removal of that sediment that you just mentioned, does that include the bottom of Lake Alice? The way that you postured your question, the way it's written in the plans there, is that you could just be removing the silt that was the dam, former dam, former Lake Alice dam. And so my question is, since then, there's been thousands of tons of silt that have shown up from the bottom of Lake Alice into Lake Lanier. Is that going to be removed also?
Yes.
What was the extent of the core samples?
It's preliminary, no extent, no final. It's in process.
Do you all speak for the mayor?
No.
Well, what are we doing here?
We're taking public input on the plan so then we can turn that information over to the engineers for further development.
Yes, I have a few slides that I'd like to share with you that show what has happened and what we're planning on doing. He asked for some information. I think it might be good if you give some information to the public. These are just background slides initially. And as you all know, well, some of you might know, Lake Alice was built and designed in the 1930s as an earth-filled dam. By the way, if I speak with a funny accent, so if you don't hear me properly, let me know and I'll speak up a little louder or a little slower. The total area that drains into the Lake Alice dam is about 600 acres in total. And of those 600 acres, as you, some of you are aware, it has been developed over time since Lake Alice was constructed. And of course, in May of 2013 is when we had the rain event. The dam was topped and the dam was breached. And this has resulted in tons of sediment that has entered into Lake Lanier from the lake bed and from erosion off the lake bed as well. This map up here just shows you the drainage basin. Right here is Lake Alice. This is Lake Lanier right here. This is Marketplace Boulevard, and that is Sanders Road. As you can see, this is all this area upstream is all developed. You see all the public pavement inside. Now, so what are the existing conditions right now? Now, this first picture that I have here shows the dam breach location. This is where the dam has breached. And the location is about a 25-foot wide breach. This is a closer view of the dam breach location. You see that the size of the dam collapsed. And you have some trees that are now within the stream channel. Now, as a result of the breach, I'm not sure how well you can see this, but this is an aerial photograph that was taken after the breach occurred. And this outline right here is Lake Alice. This location right here is where the dam, the ocean of the dam was located. I'm not sure if you can see clearly, but if you look closely, there's lines that follow in the stream channel. Because the lake, the dam breached and the lake emptied out, all flows that enter the lake right now flow directly into the stream, the lake bed. And as a result of this, we have new stream channels forming within the lake bed. And that is the source of the sediments coming out of the lake bed currently and flowing down into the lake again. This picture shows salt channels forming within the lake bed. This is a stream channel within the lake bed. Now, one of the problems that we have is as the stream channels are being formed, the new stream banks are very unstable. As you can see in this picture right here, you see all this sloughing off of the stream banks. So when it rains, water rises within the stream banks, hits these areas that are unstable, and erodes them further, washing sediments down into Lake Nydia. Now, so part of the remediation that we are going to perform, the main objective is to basically eliminate the lake bed erosion and stop the excessive erosion of sediment discharge into Lake Nydia. We were proposing to do this in two ways. One, we're going to construct a weir structure, which I'll talk about later, tell you what that is exactly. And then we're also going to stabilize the stream banks by planting vegetation on the stream banks. Now, a weir structure basically is an obstruction that is placed within the stream channel. And what this does is it is designed to allow water to pond upstream of the weir, and at the same time allow water to flow over the weir going downstream. This picture right here shows you what a weir how it normally functions. So this is a concrete weir actually. This is the wall of the weir. So as you can see, the weir basically is a wall built across the stream channel. The upstream end then form a small lake, and the water will then overflow over top the weir. That's the way it's designed. And allow the water to flow downstream, and that will be flowing down into Lake Nydia.
With that photo, what happens when a big rain takes place? Before, there was a dam pipe that controlled the flow, but that looks like that when a big rain happens, it's just going to flow over that whole thing, and that there will be an increase in turbidity and an increase in volume of water prior to what took place. Is that accurate?
There would be an increase in volume. There would not be an increase in volume of water over what it is right now. I mean,
over what it is now, but what about before?
Over what it is before, because remember, volume of water is, if it rains 2 inches over an acre, whether you have a lake or you have a weir structure, you still have the same volume of water and it's going to flow out of the dam.
But it went out of a pipe at a controlled rate. That's not a pipe at a controlled rate. That's just a place where it flows over, am I right?
You're right. That's different. The rate is different from the volume. Volume would be the same. The rate is different. But again, a weir structure is, as you can see, you have a notch right here. The rate at which the water flows from a weir structure is controlled by the height of the water above the weir. So you can design your weir to control the volume, the flow rates, to ensure that they are at the levels they were before you put the weir in.
How tall will the weir be?
Would be part of our design. We haven't completed the design yet.
I mean, that one doesn't look like more than a couple of feet.
Well, it doesn't look that way because you cannot see, you don't know what the depth of the lake is behind the weir. So it could be 6 feet, it could be 12 feet, but you can't see that from this drawing right here.
Do you know who Ford Gravett is?
Who what?
Ford Gravett.
No, I don't. Can you please tell me who he is?
He's the mayor. He's the mayor.
He's the mayor. He's the one. City. I guess he's the one who hired you.
No. I was hired by the city. I was hired by the Mashburn family.
Is there anybody in charge here tonight, or is Ford Gravett in the building?
Excuse me, sir. Are you on the list to speak? And
are you? No, I mean, this is getting pretty interesting. Is Ford Gravett in the building?
Sir.
Is Ford Gravett in
the
building?
Why don't you go look for him?
I don't want to get arrested.
Right, they arrest
people.
Well,
why don't
you
not disturb this meeting? Let's get on with the meeting, Dr. Moses.
Well, do you have a question?
Yes, I would like Mr. Moses to be happy to go look for Ford Gravett so we could get on with this meeting.
Now, as we said before, the problem with the erosion in this lake bed is because the water has left the lake. So what we're proposing to do is build the weir high enough to cover all the uniform stream channels that are currently eroding. So we're going to create basically a smaller lake where the original lake was.
How small?
Currently, we're doing investigations. We're trying to identify all areas where the stream channel is highly erodible. Once we figure out the areas that are susceptible to erosion, then we will build the weir to cover all those areas. So I cannot tell you exactly what the height of the weir is going to be right now.
That sounds like a dam.
There's a difference between a dam and a weir.
Dams are regulated in Georgia sometimes, but weirs are never regulated, right?
I'm not quite sure exactly. It depends on the structure you're talking about. I mean, all these structures have some regulation attached to them. But the main difference is that weirs are smaller than dams, and that is what we're creating, right? Smaller dam, well, not a dam, a smaller drainage structure. So all the areas that are currently eroded revert back to what they were before the dam breached, and that should stop the erosion within the lake bed and eliminate the sediments being discharged into the canal. Now, there are various types of weirs. We have concrete weirs, sheet pile weirs, or rock field weirs. Again, the final weir structure that we're going to design and build will depend on what our investigations show. Currently, we're trying to determine A, what type of soils we have in the area, whether they have enough strength to carry different types of materials. We're trying to figure out what the cross section of the newly formed channels are. We're trying to figure out what areas are being eroded. And then we'll come up with the final design. That's all I have now.
Lights, please.
Thank you, Dr. Wilkin. Our next speaker on the list is Ms. Deborah Abbott.
My name is Deborah Abbott, and I reside at 1035 Timberlake Trail. And I've been living there since 2001. And we live right down from the lake access on Timberlake Trail. We're right next to it, the three lots that are the lake access. I guess we're in a certain state of confusion too. We love the lake, we love living here. Like all of our neighbors, we're very upset. We miss Memorial Day party, we miss 4th of July party, Labor Day party. We're afraid to let grandkids into the lake, you know, just the concerns that everyone has. And I guess right now, the one thing that we've been looking at is that there's really no definition of cove or how much will be dredged, as we've talked about in this remediation plan. And news articles are talking about 50 homeowners. We're not sure what cove means. The area of photos that we've looked at show the silt going down as far as Habersham Marina. So we're not sure, where are we now? What are we doing? How far is the cove going to be dredged? And we would like to have something specific in the remediation plan to show that, because we're kind of in the middle there. We don't know, are you coming down to our cove? Are you going down to Habersham Marina? Where is the cove? We're also assuming that docks and waterways are going to have to be moved. And I would assume if that is the case, that this will be covered, that we will not have to do that, and the expenses of doing that will be covered by the city of Cumming, by whomever, we don't know. And right now, just, you know, a lot of things aren't thought of, but right now, for those of us who have boats in the water, our boats are getting ruined right now. They're filthy. The docks have scum all over them. A lot of things that we don't expect remuneration for, but we just want you to be aware of the fact that there are a lot of things happening to us right now that we have to deal with, and most of us are not very happy with the situation. We also don't know whether we can stick a toe down in the water now. We don't have any beautiful birds anymore. We don't have fish. We don't have the fishermen. I wouldn't even like to have those fishermen going past my dock, causing a lot of problems. You know, they go 100 miles an hour, but right now I'd love to see some, because right now we don't have any of that. Our lake is not our lake anymore, and that's what we pay for. Our backyard is definitely not the value of our house, it's the value of what's in our backyard. So we're concerned about getting this fixed and what it really means. Also, the weir, I guess we're all confused about the weir, and I know that you were trying to explain to us about the weir. And is there a plan B? What if the weir is put in and it isn't sufficient enough to handle the water situation? What happens? Can the weir be made taller or whatever in the long run? Well, we don't really understand this whole situation about the weir versus the dam and how it works. We've seen all, you gave us wonderful engineering papers, but like I think John said, we don't know all the engineering ifs, ands, and buts. So we kind of like to know, in layman's terms, what are we looking at here? And if somebody could kind of explain that to us, I think it would help all of us in this room, because we don't understand the whole situation of the weir. And I know you tried to give us a little overview, but I'm still confused, and I would think maybe one other person in this room is confused also. anyway, that's where we are right now. Mainly, it's been 8.5 months, and we don't know where things are going. Are we going to have another? Obviously, looks like we're going to have another summer without anything in our backyard for our enjoyment. So where are we? For those of us who wanted, you know, we don't even know whether we should put any more money into our houses, or we are going to be able to sell our house. If this situation is not rectified, we're all in a world of hurt, because that's what our investment is this lake, and we love it. And to me, I don't know how other people feel in this room, but I've enjoyed living in the city of Cumming. I came from Atlanta. It's like living on another planet up here. It's a wonderful place to live, and we want to keep it wonderful, and it's not right now. So that's all I have to say. If you could just answer those questions, I'd appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Doc Welton is the mayor person, so in regards to the limits of what being moved in code, we've got the field work done, preliminary field work based on cores of the code. We may have to go out and do a few more, but as I stated earlier, the sediment that is in the cove, due to the dam breach, will be removed, or we will not get the core permit. So the means and methods of that removal, as far as your boat docks go, before we get the core permit, we will have to have a quantity that would be downstream of Sanders Road, and we have a quantity upstream of Sanders, which would be in the flooding. We have to have that information on these plans before the Corps will issue us a permit. So the means and methods of removing the sediment has not been determined yet, but it will be determined, and that will determine whether your boat docks are in the way or not.
Where did you core sample?
I can't hear you, Rick.
Where did you core sample? Where in the lake? How many docks into the cove or down in the cove?
As far as where they That's been done. We have not seen them before yet, so we have core sampling code.
When we saw them in the cove, they only did core sampling inside the turbidity curtains, which is about 80 or 90% was missed.
I don't know the exact locations, but we have the field work done waiting on Did I answer your question? You said it because I wrote it down, but did I miss anything other than weird?
I still don't understand. I don't think I ever really understand this weird situation.
Weird, okay. Dr. Wellington is a weird man.
Let me try to explain this out. The problem you have right now is that the cove is filling up with sediments. And the sediments are coming from the lake bed as is right now. Now, say for instance you go out in your yard with a hose and spray the ground. The force of the water is going to erode the ground. It's going to wash away the soil, and that will form your sediments and will go downstream. Now, if you go out to your yard and it has rained, it's raining, you have lots of water. Say there's a pond of water in your backyard. If you use your hose and spray on in the same location, because you have water in that area, you cannot hit the soil. You cannot erode the soil. You cannot remove sediment from your soil and wash it downstream. That is what the wear is going to do. The wear is going to create a wall in the stream channel that's going to cause water to pump behind it. So you have a little pond. And therefore, when water comes into the pond, the water cannot hit the base of the lake bed any longer. And therefore, you will not have erosion. And therefore, therefore, once the cove has been cleaned out, new sediments will not come down to the cove from the lake bed. That is how the waste stock is supposed to work.
But if it doesn't work properly, is there a plan to adjust it, or can you adjust the weir?
I believe it will work properly. We're not just going out and building something. We're doing engineering studies, we're doing calculations to design a weir that is going to work efficiently and provide enough capacity to limit the amount of erosion to eliminate the erosion that is occurring within the lake bed. It will work properly.
Who will own and maintain the weir?
Whoever owns the lake.
Who does? Does anybody know who owns it?
You can look in the plans, and there's sheet 2.1 that has proper information.
Okay. Who will maintain the weir?
It's according to where the weir goes. So we don't have the exact location.
We don't know yet who will maintain it.
So, did I answer your question, ma'am?
Yes. One other thing, though, as far as the cove, I think there should be a definition of what the cove is in the remediation plan. What does the cove encompass? And if we could have a definition of exactly what's going to be dredged, what areas are going to be dredged, if that could be in the plan. Not that there's going to be dredging, but what areas specifically will be dredged?
That will be a dredging plan that later, it probably, I'm not sure it will be a part of the remediation plan, but before dredging occurs, there will be a dredging plan that will be prepared and submitted for approval to the Corps. So once it's determined where the dredging and removal is, it will be pinned down to locations, and it will be a plan with means and methods of removal.
Because right now we just don't have that specificity in the plan at all. There is not.
That the information is being gathered for that specificity, and it may or may not be a part of this plan, but it will be a plan that you can look at and tell what's going to be removed. And it'll be a quantity also.
Can I say something? That's a question? Actually, sir, we're... Yeah, go ahead. Come on up to the
what's happening. Yes. Right now, we still feel like kind of in the dark.
So you say your name, please.
My name is Terry Sweeney. I live very close to where the breach is. Excuse me?
What is your address?
1580 Turner Road. I don't know what that matters, but anyway, the weir structure, we know that's not going to work. It's basically just a little tiny waterfall. What you need to do is change the plans a little bit. I'm not going to tell you exactly how to do it, but my family's been in the construction business for a long time. Water tunnels, dams, things like that. The thing is, my one, now this is not a Lake Lanier picture, is it? This is just somewhere from somewhere else.
Yes, it's a stock picture.
A stock picture. So we know that doesn't even apply to Lake Lanier. Now my question is when is it ever going to start? I mean, if you're talking about it now, you're going to build a weir, whatever, it's going to take like 2-3 years to do that, approval, all this other stuff. So that means more silt is going to be filling into this Lake Alice. My other question is, how much is this going to cost? Any clue, are there numbers, insurance quotes, or anything like that? Well, just off the top of somebody's head. 100 million? We're talking a big project here. Where's all the money going to come from? Just questions. I mean, you guys have to know about numbers. I mean, come on. But anyway, is it going to cost more than a $100 million jail that we're building? We don't have any crime, but we have a project. We have another project that's a problem here. We got a $100 million jail. So this project must be $100 million.
The project will not be $100 million.
Less, more?
Less.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you.
Our next speaker on the list is Mr. Jim Hickson.
My name is Jim Hickson. I live at 965 Timber Lake Trail, approximately a quarter of a mile below the breach or Sanders Road. I've lived on the lake since 1997, 17 years. During that time, they had the construction of all the commercial that you see now. And every time it would rain, Lake Alice would hold water back, which it did for 80 years. Now that we have asphalt and impervious surface over it, we had a lot of rain, about 4 or 5 inches, I think, and it broke the dam, breached it. Your weir structure sounds like a good idea, but what I'm hearing is it's basically going to allow the water to puddle or make a smaller lake in the bed of Lake Alice. Is that correct?
That's correct.
What is going to stop all the silt coming in? And we have a new subdivision going in on the Buford Dam Road, and they have the silt fences in place, but we all know that that's not going to stop all this orange and the turbidity getting in the lake now. When I moved in this house 17 years ago, I had 14 feet of water at my dock. Today, I don't know exactly what it is because I've had to pull my boat out. But when the dam breached, the water came over Sanders Road at a high rate of force and approximately 4 feet deep. Can we put the other slide back up there, sir?
Which one?
The second slide, I think it was. Or no, sir, of the cove, the aerial view.
The aerial view of the cove?
Yes, the aerial view of the cove. Yes, sir. One back, I guess. It showed the bootleg. It was very early on, I guess.
This is the cove right here.
Okay, right there, where your cursor is. You see the narrow point? No, sir, not there. All that's now filled in with turbidity or with silt. Keep coming on out toward the lake. I live right there, and in that area right there, when that water came down through there, it is my opinion, because I saw the lake when it was 18 feet down, and when that water made that turn, these people down there are also going to be affected, because that's where the water stopped flowing so fast. And I feel pain of these people out in that part of the cove as well, because that's where the settlement, I think, is going to be 3-4 feet deep just because of this breach. There was a lot of dirt. I mean, there was a plug of dirt that came out of the dam the size of this room, was there not? Plus what's come out of off the creek beds, as you're alluding to now, and it's going to continue to come until we get it repaired. And I think we're all, I'm sorry that we're vending at you guys tonight, but we've been without Sanders Road now for almost a year. And I think we're all concerned, really, that the lake be returned the way it was. Not just the silt right there at Sanders Road, but well on out, because that was a lot of water came through there fast. And every time it rains now, I have pictures on my phone where I stop frequently and take pictures of it's orange because of the turbidity. The first turbidity fence failed because of so much silt. The second one is now in jeopardy because it's continuing to come. So I guess I've vented and I appreciate your time. I hope the other neighbors feel kind of the same way. We just want to fix back.
Thank you for coming, sir.
Next speaker on the list is Mr. Jim Bob.
Thank you. My name is Jim Bob. I live on 1495 Green Forest Trail. And I think in the very first slide that you showed, there's a term on there that says this will stop excessive silt from going into the lake. What is the proper amount of silt that should go into the lake?
I can't give you the number right now, but all watersheds have a natural amount of siltation that occurs. What I refer to as excessive silt is the erosion is occurring within the lake bed as the
Do you admit that either now or from time to time, in the near present, excessive silt is going into the lake? Is now, or in the near present, last week, next week, is excessive silt going into the lake?
The lake bed is eroding.
Well, why is it taking so long to do this? I mean, you hear the people, they've had their property damaged, you say you got to study something, the weir, and you say that core samplings have been taken, but nobody knows where. What is the definition of that you will be using to determine where you have cored enough? In other words, you must have an engineering guideline that says if the dirt is green or orange or has leaves in it or is this thick or is it this kind, what are your engineering guidelines you're using to make that determination?
The first phase of the study took some core samples to see if it could define the limits.
What did the core samples show? I'm not asking you where they are. Is it there's got to be gold in them, or it's got to have dollar bills in it? What is it?
Could you ask the question, and I'll answer.
All right.
And then let me answer, and you can ask another question.
What I'm trying to get
confused on what
I'm trying to get at is from an engineering point of view.
Yes.
What allows anybody, an engineer or anybody else, properly or improperly, to be able to say when I look at this core sample, I can tell that this is an area for which we're not going to dredge anything.
Okay.
On the other hand, another coil sample, and you look at it and you say, this is an area where we're going to have to take some silt back. What is it you're looking for?
Visually, when you take a tube, you take a core, visually you can tell what's new sediment and what is old sediment.
Based on what?
Visually, color, texture. You can tell from the sample what's new silt and what is old silt. There'll be a leaf layer.
Is there a photo we could get? We could go out and take samples ourselves and tell you, look at that. I don't have silt, but he does.
Is that a question?
Yeah. Is it that easy?
You got to be qualified to do that. And the third party is qualified to take the course and tell visually, you know, what's old silt and new silt. Is preparing a report that reflects that. So they go out, they preliminary go out, they check an area, and then they go out again and check an area to see the limits of the silt.
Okay. Now, you're employed by the city?
Yes, I'm
by this project?
By the city, yes.
And you're employed by?
Mashburn.
And so, can we be assured that there will be always agreement of where these cores, the silt is excessive?
By default, it's contained in the cores. I mean,
But it takes an expert of some kind or expertise to be able to look at it. A normal person can't make that assessment.
No, a normal person could probably take the assessment. I'm not sure they could write a report. But a normal person could look at the tube where the core is extracted, and they can tell, you know, somebody can say, this is new and this is old, and you would probably understand it, and it would make sense that that's a new cell and that's old cell.
All right.
But you couldn't write the report up, but you could tell, you know, from looking, the color, the texture, and they could explain it, and you could understand it.
Okay. My final question, I believe, is about the weir. On the plan itself, it shows rock, some sort of rock, I'm going to say gravel. I think there are at least four levels of it. Two before Sanders Road and two would look to me like it's actually on core property. Whether the weir, you haven't determined what the weir is going to be made out of yet, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay, so can it be rock?
It can be rock.
And can it be these very rock structures that are shown on the plans?
No.
Okay, if the weir goes in, will these rock structures go away?
Rock dam number one.
I think, Mr. Paul, you're talking, the weir is here and then there's riprap on each side.
Yeah.
That's basically for channel stabilization.
Those will stay in place because when the water cascades over the weir, it comes with some kind of some force. And if you have sediment soil, it would erode that. So you put the riprap in place as a reinforcement.
That would not go away.
Okay.
Will
not go away.
Yes.
And who will eventually the silt that otherwise would have gone in the lake will either be behind the weir or behind one of these dams? Is that probable?
Behind the weir, yes.
But not behind the dams?
There are no dams. The riprap you're seeing is on grade. You understand? There would be a weir that would stick up, say, 10 to 12 feet, and then the riprap would be below. So
it's not
impounding water.
Okay.
The rock you're looking at is not impounding water.
Okay, and all right, then go back to the weir. Who's going to clean out the stuff behind the weir? How often, and what happens if they don't?
Again, whoever owns the lake would be responsible to clean out behind the weir.
It's taken us 6 months, apparently, to figure out who owns what pieces of the lake.
Look on sheet two. There's a very detailed drawing.
And I agree, except that was drawn in August.
Yes.
We're still talking about, we don't know where we're going to do this. We don't know if it's a weir. We're still studying this. We're still studying that and the other thing. I mean, these people are trying to go swimming.
I understand your frustration, sir. I know that you guys want to enjoy your lake as you envisioned it. But these things are complex, and I'm sure you would not want us to come up with a solution and then 6 months from now, we're back at the same point. So all I can say is I'm sending frustration, and I just hope that you guys will have a little patience with us until we get it done right. That way we, you know, when it's done right, you guys would not be in this place again talking about this. That is our goal.
All right, so when do you think you'll be done with this?
I don't want to put a time out. I don't want to put a time on right now. I don't want to say something and then the next minute I have to contact myself. I would just ask you guys to be patient, let the process run its course, and at the end of the process, you have your way back for your enjoyment.
That's pretty bad. I mean, when, for example, is Sanders Road going to be open?
That is, let's see, yeah.
From a permitting standpoint, in all I'm addressing the politics of Sanders Road, I'll address the actual construction. We're trying to permit the culvert to the core because it's located. The right of way, I think, is 60 feet. The wing walls of the culvert are outside the right of way, which throws us into a different permit. So the city is procuring that permit. Unfortunately, they had to do research about the road right of way as far as the core is concerned to see if it threw us in another category, if the right of way, if the road was there before the dam, before the lake was built or after the build, it was a right-of-way issue. All that is almost worked out, but as far as the culvert itself, we are procuring that permit as fast as we can. We don't have it in hand, but we're working on that.
And that permit comes from whom?
The Corps of Engineers. Because it's actually in the flood easement. The invert of the culvert is 69 and a half, which is actually, it's in the normal pool. It's a little bit below the normal pool, but the wing walls of the culvert, which we have to have, can't delete them, is outside the right-of-way, which is on the core. The downstream is in outside the flood easement, but the upstream is in the flood easement, so we're pretty much, we've covered up with the core on both sides. So we're procuring that permit to the core. We don't have it, but we are working on it.
Okay. Thank you.
What's the height of what's the maximum height of a rock weir, and what causes you to use a rock weir versus another type of weir?
There's no maximum height.
So you could have a 500-foot rock weir?
Well, then you wouldn't do it. I mean, then you're talking about a dam instead of a weir.
Precisely. Well, thank you. Go ahead.
Yeah, but the type of material you use will depend on the soil type, whether you have rocks, the stream channel has bedrock immediately below the surface. It all depends on what you find.
Who will determine if we have another public hearing? What'd you say? Call the next speaker?
I told Mr. Burns, I believe that we would take that. From your comments, you may have asked about the need for another public hearing. We'll take that under advisement and see if that's going to be necessary.
Who makes that decision?
Our next speaker is Ms. Miguel McAlpin Temple. I'm sorry, ma'am?
I changed my mind.
Okay, all right, thank you.
There's somebody with their hand up.
Ms. Tisdale, you listed on your, you were not speaking, is that correct?
Thank you for recognizing me. I just want to announce that this video will be available on YouTube in a day or two. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
There's a hand up in the back, Mr. Morgan. Maybe they missed the opportunity to sign up.
Well, as I said, Mr. Meadows, the sign up had to be done at the time the hearing started.
Were there rules established for who can speak? Are you going to deny somebody the opportunity to speak?
Mr. Meadows, you had your 10 minutes, if you would please move on to the next speaker. Our next speaker is Ms. Mary Wilson.
Don't let him speak.
I'm sorry?
I decline. All right. Thank you. Our next speaker is Mr. Mike Leahy. Well, good evening. My name is Mike Leahy. I live at 865 Timberlake Trail. Let me apologize first. We're not frustrated, we're pissed off. It's been nine months, and we still can't use our code. And nothing. Studies are great, nothing's been done to stop it. I mean, they haven't even done pay bales when we're the dam used to be to help filter out some of that stuff. I understand that they planted vegetation on the stream bed, but why not just throw some hail base? Why not do something temporary to help reduce this? Nothing, in my opinion, has been done to rectify the situation so far. So I'm sorry. You know, I came here tonight looking for answers, and I've got a bunch of we don't know. It's still being planned. We're still studying this. We're trying to get permits. So basically, the only thing that you can tell me for certain at this point is that you're going to use a weir structure. But you can't tell me what it's made of. You can't tell me how large it's going to be. You can't tell me where it's located. You can't tell me who's going to maintain it. So what was the purpose of this meeting if you can't give us any answers?
Just to abandon it.
I mean, are you even aware that the first turbidity curtain that's been put in place is buried in sections by silt? The second turbidity curtain doesn't even cover the entire cove. So all the mud and silt is flowing right around it. I watched them put in the second turbidity curtain. It doesn't even reach to the bottom of the lake. Well, it probably does now with all the additional silt that's been put in since then. I'm speechless. Nobody can tell me the results of the core samples. You can't tell us where they've been taken. I mean, I would have expected for public comment that some basic information would have been included, other than here's some pretty drawings that we've paid for. When are we going to have those answers? When are you going to have the results of the core samples? When are we going to have a better idea on the wear structure and what it's made out of? Am I going to be able to use my lake this summer, or am I going to go another summer without it? You know, we purchased our home a year ago, and I have a 5-year-old and an 8-year-old. And all they wanted was to swim. And in May, it was just starting to get warm enough, and the water was getting up. And, you know, they want to go fishing every day. And then one morning, it was a Sunday morning, my youngest son woke me up and said, Daddy, look, the lake's broken. And we look out and here's a massive inrush of mud and debris and trash and water. And fortunately, I did not have my boat in the dock at that time, because I can't even imagine how much damage would have been caused to my boat had it been tied in my dock at that point. So, I want to apologize, because I know you guys didn't cause this. I know you're the ones that are working to fix this. But we've had enough. We need answers. I realize that's going to take time, but I mean, are we talking a year, 2 years, 3 years? What are we looking for? What are we looking at? When do I get my lake back? Thank you.
I want to make sure the question, I'll try to write them down, but the public meeting tonight, I mean, the reason these aren't 100% complete is there may be something that comes as a result of this meeting that changes the drawings. So I want you to understand that it was on purpose that the weir was, you know, it's conceptual. And the drawings state that it's all subject to final design. So once we get the public hearing out of the way, then we can take what's said tonight, try to incorporate it into these drawings, and we can finish the drawings up. The permitting process, we're already in that now. So after this meeting, Dr. Wellington will look at the input from the public, and then if anything needs to be changed or anything needs to be addressed, we will do that and finish these drawings up. As far as telling you an exact time, I can tell you this, that we, both parties involved, We understand what you're saying, and we will get it done. But I can't give you an exact time.
And I appreciate that. And unfortunately, this is the first chance that we've had to speak, and you're catching my impossible frustration. And I will. And I do thank you for having me about that. You know, all we want is speaking for my family. We just want our goat back. We want to know it's safe to swim, and we want to know it's not going to happen again. And we want to know that the silt and the sediment that, you know, has the cove just, I mean, visibility today, it was probably 2 feet. You know, last Easter, my son dropped his grandfather's dip net that my grandfather had for 20-something years and hadn't had it back into the bottom of the lake. And at that point, we had 12 feet of water under my dock, and I could still see this, you know, little minnow net sitting in the bottom, you know, 12 feet down. We checked over the weekend, we have 6 feet of water. And the lake level is within a foot or so.
One thing is certain, is for us to get our permit, we have to make the core whole in the sense that we have to remove that sill. So that's not a if and but.
And all they can do is ask that once the designs are finalized and the permits are approved, that it would be, I would ask you just to share that information with us, even if it's just through the City of Cumming's website again, or if it's through another public meeting as well. And I would ask also that if there is another public meeting, that you could start off with a presentation like Dr. Wellington had, and give us an idea of what we're actually looking at on these plans. We're not engineers, I'm an MBA, so if it was money, no problem, we've got to cover. But from an engineering perspective, I understand what it's supposed to be saying, but I don't understand the details in an engineer would. And I'm just asking that if we do have another public meeting, that you could give us a presentation and walk us through and explain a lot of the terms and technology issues.
I think as a result of the public hearing, the powers that be are hearing, say you want another hearing, they will take that into consideration. And I know we're absolutely sure that these finished drawings will be made available to the public. I know that for sure.
That's all I've got. Thank you, gentlemen, very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Good evening. I've presented some written comments to the parties to consider. My name is Kevin Jesselnick. I'm an attorney with Stack & Associates. We represent some of the Cove property owners that have been impacted by the lake failure. We just have a couple questions and a couple comments for you tonight. First, we'd ask that the parties post the transcript of the public hearing that we have. For the public to review, whether that's on the city's website or what have you, we ask that be provided for our review. And to further that, we ask that you provide public comments that are submitted via writing to the public for review as well. Just kind of whatever you've gathered from everyone, you make that available for the public to review as well. And we have a couple questions in relation to the nature of this meeting itself. We're just kind of curious what the parties really intend to do with all the information that's being obtained tonight. It doesn't appear to be an EPD mandated meeting like a lot of the public hearings of this nature are. So where an agency has oversight to ensure that all the comments are collected, digested, and considered. So an initial question is what the parties here intend to do with all the comments you're getting.
From an engineering standpoint, maybe there's been discussion of where, which is Dr. Wellington's, but basically to get information. I think Brand's brought up some points, but from an engineering standpoint, we would take that and look at the drawings and see if that needed to be incorporated, if we need to make changes on these drawings as far as completion of the design.
Okay. Who has the actual or final authority to consider these comments, potential revisions, and actually enact any changes to the remediation plan?
You need to repeat that.
Who has the final authority, the decision-making ability to, as to what revisions are made, what changes are made to the remediation plan?
From an engineering standpoint, it would be Dr. Wellington and myself. Are you talking about engineering, or are you talking about engineering revisions, or what exactly? When you said revisions, what exactly revisions are you talking about?
Well, from an engineering standpoint, or just from a final say-so when it comes to, the determination of what type of weir or the size and cost measures and the things of that nature, what you are the final arbiters, I guess.
The final decision would be the engineer of records plus the permitting authority, which is the EPD, Corps of Engineers. So, I mean, the engineer would be Dr. Lowe and myself, but it's also the permitting authority to have input to the final time.
Is there a timeline or process for, you know, going forward for considering all these comments or potential revisions and making the changes necessary?
ASAP, yes.
And what role does the EPD play in this particular process here, this public participation process and gathering of the public input?
Could you repeat that?
What role is EPD playing here in this public participation and consideration of the comments and revisions to the plan?
I think none.
Who made the final decision really not to replace the dam with another dam but to go to the rear instead? And then why was that a decision that was made?
We decided not to replace the dam with the dam because as you can see from what happened, when you have it in place, you have a lot of environmental problems. Whereas the weir would have less environmental impacts. That was why the decision was made to go with the weir to the dam.
And throughout this process, did the decision makers and the parties involved consider the property rights of those property owners downstream and how those rights are being impacted by, you know, the decision not to replace the dam and instead go with this weir structure?
That's an engineering question. It's not a legal question. Dr. Rowland can answer that. So
can't hear you. Talk to the microphone. We can't hear you.
And a few more questions. Curious if the parties intend to provide the core sample data and other pieces of data like the PowerPoint presentation shown today. And any other reports or data generated, are you going to be sharing those with the public?
Yes, upon final completion, yes.
Okay. We have a couple questions about kind of monitoring and sampling water quality in the area. Has there been any water quality or testing for metals or fecal or, you know, suspended solids, COD, BOD, things of that nature?
I think prior to I don't know for sure, but I think there was some sampling that was done in the beginning because it's a lift station in the general vicinity of Sanders Brother. I haven't seen the results, but I think there was some testing to make sure there wasn't leakage from the lift station.
Have there been any storage tanks or any other above ground or below ground storage tanks identified at the Lake Alice property?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. You know, we'd ask that the parties engage in some extensive water sampling at multiple points, for example, where the creek enters and leaves Lake Alice, the former Lake Alice, in the creek at Sanders Road, and in the lake near Cove. We'd ask that there's some monitoring and sampling of that water quality, particularly those constituents mentioned, metals, fecal, TSS, COD, and BOD. I would ask that data could be shared with the public as well. I'd also like to ask if, before the dam breach, had the city ever inspected the Lake Alice Earthen Dam or the emergency spillway or the overflow pipe that's present?
I do not know the answer to that.
All right, that's all the questions I have. If I have some time remaining, I'd like to cede it to the woman who was in the back and see if she makes some comments. Thanks.
Very nice.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you offering me the same courtesy that you did when Mr. Sweeney allowing a person who is on the list to speak. I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
And thank you.
My question is...
Excuse me, could you say your name?
I'm so sorry. My name is Cindy Boff, and my address is 1495 Green Forest Trail. My question concerns sediments. As most of the people have said here, we are not engineers. I'm a high school science teacher. So we may not fully understand all of the engineering things that you're referring to. But one thing that I think is a really concern for everyone is the amount of silt that is in the cove and continues to fill the cove. You've talked about that it's apparent in visually inspecting these sediments by an expert that you're able to tell what's new sediment and what's old sediment. So my question is, how much of the new sediment will you be removing? Will you remove all of the new sediments that have come from Lake Alice? Or is there an acceptable level of sediment that is new that you will leave?
It will be all of the sediment.
I beg your pardon?
All of the sediments.
So you will actually go out and core sample all of the areas. I think maybe, I feel uncomfortable likening this, but it's the only thing I can think of that maybe I can compare it to. When you're having a cancerous lesion removed, you take the lesion out and you continue to do the margins until they come back clear. And I think most of us have had that experience or are aware of that process. Trying to put your method of sampling into terms that the rest of us may understand, is that the process that you'll go through in finding the core samples, you'll continue to sample further and further downstream from the breach of the dam until you come to an area that has no sediment, and that's the area that the dredging will take place? Is that accurate?
That's pretty close, yes.
So you will, but the goal is to remove all sediment.
We've been instructed by the Corps of Engineers that whatever silt was from the result of the dam breach will be removed from the cove. So it will be quantified, it will be documented that that is removed, and that will be part of the permit.
So all sediments will be removed?
All sediment as a result of the dam breach. Not all sediments, because there's sediments in there that weren't a result of the dam breach.
And how will you determine that? How will you determine that the sediment came from the dam breach rather than, say, the new construction that they're doing on Buford Dam where the dam wall is clearing that they're doing there now? How does one, since those areas geographically are so close together, you would assume that the soil would be very similar in Lake Alice, as to say the lot that's being clear cut all the way down Beaver Dam Road. How would one say that the sediment, and I understand that none of us are experts, but just to help us understand a little bit more clearly, how will you be able to tell that those sediments are from that dam breach, which happened quite a long time ago? How does one do that? I know you said you could visually tell, but...
Well, from the standpoint of looking at the core sample, It wasn't that long ago. You have a distinct color difference and you have a different texture.
So just from across the street, it's going to be totally different? Is that
right? Across the street,
I understand.
You can't. The permit that they're working under across the street does not allow them to put silt in the cove.
And the permit across the street was granted by whom?
Well, there's a state permit as far as sediments runoff. That's you have to come under monitoring procedures that the EPD issues, and the local governing issue authority is the city of Cumming. So the
local government would issue an order that said no silt can come from current projects into the lake area. I guess I'm just
there's laws in place where
which obviously haven't held up very well, as we're all evidence to, unfortunately.
Pardon me?
It seems like those regulations haven't been holding up very well as we've been inundated in that cove with silt for.
But the cove, the silt in the cove wasn't from a development. Okay.
And so the idea that Lake Alice was serving as a de facto retention pond for all that impervious surface on Marketplace Boulevard has no impact, you think, on this at all?
Could you repeat the question?
Marketplace Boulevard has been developed extensively, and all of the runoff from that impervious surface goes across into Lake Alice, which is functioning as a retention pond, basically, for
there,
all
there's
that.
Retention ponds within. All the developments since 94 were installed under stormwater management ordinance.
And I guess that pipe that goes under the road that dumps right into the Marianas is a part of that storm, a part of that stormwater management.
You're talking about the culvert under Sanders Road?
No, sir. I'm talking about the one that goes under Marianas.
Which one? Which pipe are you talking about?
The one adjacent to Lane 3, Mid Alice.
That this culvert under the road is not a stormwater management facility. There's stormwater management facilities within that watershed that you have to adhere to. It's the same ordinance the county goes by. If you develop within that watershed, you have to put a stormwater management facility, which is totally different than a pipe under the road. So since 94, 95, there's been stormwater management facilities constructed with development within that watershed.
So stormwater had nothing to do with the breach of the dam?
Yes, stormwater had something to do with the breach of the dam. Stormwater.
I just wanted to be clear there.
Yes, stormwater had something to do with the breach of the dam.
So, but we should feel very comfortable and confident that the same organizations that have allow the situation that's happening now are going to be monitoring in the future both the replacement of this dam and monitoring any other cell that comes in.
Is that a question?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you should feel safe.
Thank you. I'm sure we're all happy that we feel very safe now.
I appreciate you addressing my comments. And I just want to reiterate again, all the silt that is in the lake as a result of the dam breach on Lake Alice will be removed. Is that correct?
We do not get a permit from Corps of Engineers unless we remove the silt.
Well, but permits can be received. I'm just saying, is the plan to remove it all?
I mean, I probably said it three or four times. We will remove any silt from the cove as a result of Lake Alice dam breach. That will be a condition of our permit. We do not get a permit unless we adhere and conform to that.
And you will publish that information at what time? You alluded earlier that you would do samplings and would make that information available. Do you have a timeline when that will be?
The final report would probably be complete, hopefully within 3 weeks.
3 weeks?
Hopefully within 3 weeks, the final report on the courses that we've done today will be available.
Thank you very much.
What's the purpose of quantifying?
Once you remove quantifying the amount of silt that's been removed, what's the purpose of quantifying the amount of silt? You don't want to answer my question?
If you'll have a seat for a minute, I need to ask if there is anyone else who has not already spoken who would like to speak before the meeting is concluded. Would you come up, please, sir? State your name and address for the record.
I'm Tim Rainey, Operations Manager with Corps of Engineers at Lake Lanier. And a lot of the dredging questions, I just need to clarify our directions to you. It's the quantities of sediment from the dam breach that need to be removed. We're not going to get in a trap of trying to remove every piece of sediment that came from the dam breach. That would be impossible. What we're looking for their consultants to do is determine the quantities of sediment from the dam breach and any other sediment, basically any sediment since May 19th. And that's what we're expecting them to remove. We can't go out reaches to Habersham Marina or wherever just to get 2 inches of silt. It's not effective and it's not environmentally possible, or it's actually worse environmentally to try to do that than to get the quantities where we need to get the quantities from. Just a clarification, Dan. I heard you say it several times.
Yes.
That we said you're going to get every bit of silt removed from the dam breach. We're looking at the quantities, not each and every piece from that specific action.
The volume of silt.
The volume. That's all.
Which is my question I asked.
I'll get with you after that.
else who hasn't already spoken would like to speak? Yes, come on, please, sir.
My name is Ralph Cromer. I live at 1330 Starboard Way, not too far from the breach. My only comment is that the reason a lot of people are excited, besides the inconvenience, is the lack of a communication plan. And I think you guys, primarily the city, should communicate to the public on what the plan is, the timetable. You know, we're tired of taking detours. People who live on the lake are tired of not using the lake. So please, develop communication. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll just make one comment to what you were saying is the community here doesn't operate that way.
Anyone else that would like to speak?
Yeah. I've got one more comment.
Were the recorded deed restrictions taken into account, because there was a transfer from the Mashburn family estate that went to the similar group that went to the city of Cumming. And those recorded deeds, it said and referred to Lake Alice that its purpose was to impound water, and it was to serve as a water reservoir. And those were the recorded deed restrictions. Have those been taken into account? And the recorded deed says that Lake Alice is to impound water, and it would seem to me that that was part of a plan for the development. And so now we're doing away with what was formerly being impounded and replacing it with an inadequate weir structure, despite what was on recorded deeds. Mr. Cavallo, I see you write that down. It was item number 17 on the deed restrictions of that recorded deed that was transferred, I'm pretty sure. And then there was another reference on item number 24. Thank you.
Is there any, can you respond to that?
I haven't seen the deeds, so I don't know what's in the deeds. But one thing I can say is, impoundment is impoundment. You put a weir structure, you're impounding water. So there's going to be impoundment.
But it's not a lake anymore, it's an impoundment. But I'm just saying the deed restrictions said it was for a water reservoir and it was for impoundment of water. And so it's no longer there. In fact, it said that the dam would be maintained. That's in the deed restriction as well. It uses those words. Says the dam will be maintained.
As I've said, I have not seen the deeds, and I have not worked with
them. Will you look at those?
If it's part of the engineering, I would look at them.
Can you please state your name and address for the record?
Yes, sir. My name is Joe Moses, 4745 Kim Point Road, Cumming. Dave, with all due respect, Mr. Bennett, with all due respect, and Joe, you're fine too. With all due respect, I think I just heard that, and with all due respect, I think you're a nice fellow.
I can't wait to hear what you've got to say.
But my question, we heard you explain to the nice lady that was up here, and you even made a point to say, three times I've told you that we're gonna trust us. Three times I've told you that we're gonna take let me finish the question. Three times you told her, you said, I told you three times that we were gonna take every bit of the silt out. 2 minutes later, Mr. Rainey gets up there and says, Mr. Bennett was wrong. But you said to trust you that that's what we're going to do. And then she went so far as to say, should we trust you in the future? And you said, yes. You don't need to reply to that.
No, I'm going to reply. but I was wrong in the sense of volume. I was wrong. I should have said volume will be removed.
It will be removed based on a volume basis.
But you've been wrong about lots of things.
And what else would I want to do?
Well, I'll withdraw that comment. Let me say one more thing here, and just kind of on a personal level, because
Let's don't get personal in here.
This guy doesn't want to be talking about Ford. So I'm not talking about Ford, even though I'm sure he's in the building somewhere, and I wish that he had been here to meet with people, but he's not. I don't know how y'all came to be here, but that's fine. My question is that you and Scott, Mr. whatever, that y'all are getting a lot of abuse heaped on you tonight, it looks to me like. As a result of some of this stuff. And my question to you is, you know, y'all put up here in the first line of defense to kind of stand in front of the political animals. And we appreciate that. But my question is, how's that working out for y'all? Is it worth it in the long run to lay down with the dogs? Because as you've heard me say, my mama always said, when you lay down a dog, you get up with the fleas. Do y'all really want to get up with the fleas?
Anything else?
Spell your name, Dr. Lee. And I apologize, I should have asked this earlier, and I didn't think about it. I know you're going to remove all the sediment at the center of the cove since the date of the dam breach, or at least attempt to do so.
On a volume basis.
Right, absolutely. Yeah, I understand. That's fine. My question is, what's going to be the first step done? Will the weir structure be put in place first, and we'll continue to measure the sediment, and then take core samples and then dredge, or will it happen simultaneously? I guess my question really revolves around when the weir structure is being built and Sanders Road is being constructed. How can we make sure that sediment that enters the lake at that point as well will be removed also?
Is there
kind of one order the process will occur in?
Our intentions is to do the dredging at the very end, and we would basically have a quantity that would be confirmed prior to that dredging. But it would be the absolute last thing that would be done. That dredging would be a part of the construction phase of the culvert. So everything upstream would have been completed, and then we go down to the culvert, and then as a part of that culvert, the stage and sequence would include the dredging of the lake. And we would firm up the quantity prior to that dredging.
Okay, awesome. That's what I assumed, but I wanted to make sure that. Thank you.
Right here.
Mr. Kelly, please.
My name is James Young. I live at 1270 Allendale Drive. The problem is just going to get worse the longer we keep debating over it. And we haven't really got any answer on any kind of start date or estimated completion date, ECD. I work in construction and construction management. And one of the parts of my job as a manager in construction is to provide my customer with ECDs, estimated completion dates. We haven't even gotten an estimated start date, I guess. So can we at least get a date when we're going to get an answer to a completion date? I mean, is it ever going to happen? I understand we got a lot of work to do and a lot of testing.
It will be included in the plans. The dates will be included in the plans. Because at that point in time, we would go further down the road on permitting, and we would know exactly where we stand on procuring the permits.
Okay.
And we would supply construction dates
and
sequence.
The longer we wait, with new revisions of these plans be possible to have to come out. I mean, more damage is being created by the day, correct?
Well, when as the day all the permits are secured, the code will be made whole from a volume standpoint and the seal that is in that code.
Okay.
So if there's silt going in the coat now, that gets calculated in the quantity to be removed. So the core would require them to be made whole from a volume standpoint in the flood easement and in the coat at the time that we do the work. So to answer your question, it'll be made whole when we do the work.
So we've got any time frame on any answers? Any time? I know my customer, I can't tell them I'll have a direct answer. I'll lose my job. So I'm just.
There's a lot of parameters involved with what we're doing.
Oh yeah.
And so you know, if I start telling you dates, at this point I can tell you that we're doing this as fast as possible. The conditions that we're under, we understand the problem, we understand it more after this meeting, but we will address it and do it as fast as possible as far as permitting goes. And construction. And we'll have a list of dates. You know, after this meeting, we know more than we knew yesterday, and we will have dates.
I would like to see some type of like milestone.
I mean, right now, or
well, at some point.
Yes, like, that will be done. That will be provided.
Or at least, like, I'll give you an answer about this.
We will give you milestones when we are sure that what we're giving you is correct.
But right now, it don't really have any kind of ballpark at all.
We don't, but after this meeting, and after we go back to the design drawing table, then hopefully we can release that. But am I right, Scott? The city, when we know that we're going to release something that we can release dates and we don't have right permit, and then all those dates change. You understand that?
I construction. Totally so, understand that. That's
so we don't want to throw out dates.
That's why we call them ECDs.
Yes.
And not CDs.
We will provide those dates when we feel comfortable doing so.
Anyone else like to speak? Please come back up.
Thank you. And this question may be better directed to Mr. Rainey, and thank you for coming. I understand this isn't your hearing, but thank you.
I would just like to understand the idea of volume sediment removal. Now, you had said, I sort of likened it to removing a cancerous growth in which you went out until you found clear margins, and you said, yes, we're going to remove it all. No, please wait. But then he said that it would be the same volume, which, just to get it clear in my mind, if you go and, okay, let's say that the volume is an area, you know, 40 cubic yards, we'll just give it a small number. Does that mean that you go somewhere in the lake and just scrape up 40 cubic yards of sediment anywhere, and then you say, oh, remediation has been accomplished? Or does it actually have to be in the area that the spill occurred? I guess most of us are concerned about the level of water under our particular docks, and or I think a lot of people are, from what I'm hearing, and that so that's where we would hope the sediment would be removed. So when I hear that it's a volume of sediment that you need to remove, does that mean that it will actually come from where it is silted up under our docks? Or will that just come from any old area that over time the sediments will all flow in to make it level again? So this, who would be the best person to answer that question? And if you are kind enough to do that. It sounds like you have more accurate information though. If you would be so good as to do that. Well, he does work for the Corps of Engineers.
I guess I wanted to clarify as far as the quantifying, not the removal, but the quantifying would be like you're talking about a skin lesion. We would quantify based on that
So would you do the removal in those
not
areas?
Not removal. You were talking removal, and I was talking about quantifying.
So that's how you determine how much to take out.
That's how we know what the quantity is.
But you may not take it out from underneath these people's
Mr.
docks.
Mr. Brady can address the volume removal.
Yeah, you are right. To give a bad analogy, really, you know, they could just go dig a hole, so to speak, and get the quantity. But we really can't answer that question until we get the consultant's sampling bag. And they've been provided, they have diagrams where the channels are, where the creek beds are, and we're going to look really and see where the majority of that is, where we can get it from. There very well could be, and I'll stand here and tell you, a case where we do not go under your dock. It just may not be feasible or worth it to get 12 inches of silt. We hope that's not the case. We hope we get most of it. But if it's in the channels, and we can maintain a positive slope, and we can reach the quantities, there's going to be a point at somewhere where there's turn to the side a little bit, where there's low diminishing on return. So, you know, again, the consultant's reports, all that will determine that extent. If it's not worth going to get 4 inches, 6 inches, 8 inches, or 12 inches, it very well may not be worth it.
But the diminishing return is on the property value of the homeowners whose dock is sitting on that now silt. You know, when you talk about diminishing return, enough, we all understand that the goal is to not spend $1 million, it's to do a cost-effective process. Mm-hmm. But the diminishing return that you're speaking of are property values. Because everybody knows a deep water lot is worth much more than one that's all silted in. And so I think that's where a lot of our concern comes from, because, you know, for most average people, you know, we don't have enormous trusts and we don't have enormous amounts of money. Our homes represent, especially when we're retired and they're paid off or something, that represents a large portion of our financial picture. You know, so we're very concerned about our high, I think we are. I don't want to speak for anyone, yes, but I feel like that
understood. Really,
most of us are in that boat.
They mentioned that these plans will be put out when they're done. That's really what I'd have to wait for on this topic.
And being on a cove, we can't chase deep water.
And the location of the time.
That's what they're saying.
We can't chase deep water. When I used to have 20 feet off the end of my dock, now I have 18. That makes a big difference during a drought. It means sitting on the bottom or having my dock floating.
And what they're saying is that they may not get to your dock.
That's right.
Because they got their quantity down by my house, and you know, the heck with you down there, you're just gonna have to suck.
Thank you, Mr. Rainey, I appreciate that. Anybody else have any comments regarding the plan?
Yeah, I'm just concerned. First of all, I've sat here and listened, and y'all have too, and it all boils down to me to one word, and the young lady back there said the word is trust. I appreciate what Mr. Rainey had to say. Even though it was painful, he came up here and told us what he thought was the truth. Or, you know, and I for one appreciate the forthrightness of the Corps of Engineers. On the other hand, the two of you guys have been parsing your words all night. That's why I asked you about earlier about laying down with the dogs and you're standing up here to protect them. It's the word called trust. We want to trust you. The deal is, please give us, and you two over there in the corner, we want to trust you. Give us some reason to trust what you tell us. Please stop parsing your words and talking in circles. And next time, if there is another meeting, I do hope that y'all come prepared, because it appears to me that y'all are ill-prepared. Thank you.
Anyone else? Trust.
Trust. Trust.
Thank you.